Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
I'm going to keep us on schedule because I know people are coming straight from work, and we are really delighted that you could join us. This is the greeting from the Council on Foreign Relations. I would really like to thank Stuart Patrick, who is my partner in crime in the hosting of this and our seminar today on 1325. We're really delighted that you could be here with us because I think the issues here, especially in Washington, are being talked about all the time, and they matter, I think, more and more each day. Abby Disney, who is joining us tonight, is a filmmaker and a storyteller who is showing us yet again that war stories do not belong only to men. And in fact, that peace stories come about oftentimes because of the involvement of women. And I think that the five-part series, Women, War, and Peace, which I really encourage you to watch all five parts of. You can see them online at womenwarandpeace.org. Really show different angles about the same story, which is that women are not collateral damage in the effort to reach peace, but they are actually active contributors. And their stories are worthy of telling. So with that, I think we're going to turn you over to about 35 minutes of video and then an incredible Q&A session with Ms. Disney and Stewart, and we were going to say once again how much delight it is that we welcome you here to CFR. Thank you. And now we'll play the video.
Men of substance do not abuse women. We are fed up with the war.
They thought that none of us would survive, to tell the truth. You cannot take our land away from us.
If you look at the frontline discussion of force, and this is what the newspapers report on, the fighting tactics, the troops, the politics, the borders, the weapons, the armies, all of those things, that is a men's story. The backline discussion of the story is how you actually exist and live and continue on living in war. That's a woman's story. That story has never been told. Warfare is a very different proposition now, in which civilians are not, quote, collateral damage, as we once called them, but really very much in the center of the war zone.
Ordinary civilians are the ones who feel the brunt from the hunger, they watch their children die, the women are the ones raped. And then after conflict, when the wars or the end of the wars are being negotiated, they are never considered.
Women say, stop violence! Stop violence! Stop violence!
I think it's way past time that we redefine what we mean by war, because there are no front lines in the wars in today's world. The fact is that in today's wars, the primary victims are women and children.
Berlin Wall in 1989 had spread hope for a new era of peace and international cooperation. And at the outset of Operation Desert Storm, the first President Bush heralded a new world order.
We have in this past year made great progress in ending the long era of conflict and Cold War. We have before us the opportunity to forge, for ourselves and for future generations, a new world order. A world where the rule of law, not the law of the jungle, governs the conduct of nations.
The U.S.-led wars in Iraq, as notable exceptions, the end of the Cold War did end the era of large international wars. Only rarely now would armies be arrayed in battle against opposing armies.
I think there's a huge difference between those types of wars and the wars we're now seeing. There were rules of war which said you're not meant to kill civilians. In contemporary wars, civilians are a target. The tactic is scaring civilians. The tactic is killing or expelling civilians, or raping women.
The 20th century old wars did kill millions of civilians, primarily due to strategic bombing from altitudes of thousands of feet. Today, the violence is smaller in scale and more intimate. Death from just yards away. In recent years, more than 30 armed conflicts, insurgencies, and all-out wars have been fought annually. From Bosnia to Afghanistan to Colombia, from the Sudan and Somalia to Sri Lanka and Libya. While the total number of combat deaths is lower today, huge numbers of civilians have been driven from their homes and terrorized by a massive proliferation of small arms and light weapons. And when we speak of civilians, for the most part, we are speaking of women. Women and all those who depend upon them for sustenance, for health care, for keeping families together as these new wars rage around them.
Think of the modern era. The war has changed because I think it's become much more simple and much more cost efficient than it used to be. During the Cold War, there were certain limits placed on what war could be in those circumstances.
Douglas Farah spent more than 20 years reporting from conflict zones. He says during the Cold War, the U.S. and Soviet blocs put limits on who got which weapons.
Immediately after the Cold War, as the weapons started to flow, and especially the cheap weapons that came out of the former Soviet bloc, where you could suddenly have access to AK-47s particularly, but also rocket-propelled grenades, anti-aircraft weapons that you could also use to shoot through entire villages, were available to those who could control commodities. And so you see this explosion of commodity wars, fighting over diamonds, fighting over gold.
Riches derived from the plunder of blood diamonds fueled the rise of Liberian dictator Charles Taylor during 14 years of civil war, in which almost a quarter of a million died. Nearly a third of the population was displaced, and it's been reported that 3 out of 4 women were raped. The conflict was sustained by plane loads of machine guns and ammunition looted from stockpiles in the former Soviet Union by a notorious arms dealer.
The man known as the Merchant of Death is coming to America. Thailand has extradited alleged Russian arms dealer Victor Boot to face terrorism charges here in the U.S.
Victor Boot, a former Soviet military officer, was indicted for agreeing to sell weapons to the Colombian terrorist group, the FARC. He is also alleged to have armed Charles Taylor and insurgent groups worldwide using surplus Cold War weapons and transport planes.
People like Victor Boot, they're feeding weapons to people who are willing to kidnap children, have them kill their own parents, and send them out on raping rampages across the countryside.
It's reported Boot also delivered weapons to the rebel army backed by Taylor next door in Sierra Leone, the Revolutionary United Front, or RUF, which used more than 10,000 child soldiers in their attacks on villages and diamond mines. There's no shortage of other rogue arms dealers already taking Boot's place. To date, there is still no international treaty regulating the global transfer of weapons.
Small arms are the bane of humanity today. There are far more people killed by small arms than we have seen killed by any other kinds of weapons. Controlling the supply and the production of these weapons is becoming increasingly difficult because you can control the formal big companies, but it's very hard to control the proliferation of counterfeiters that are small operations that generate these weapons. So it's a very thorny problem that will never be solved unless many countries develop the collective will to deal with it.
The United States has recently voted for the first time to engage in talks on a United Nations arms trade treaty, but only if the talks are operated by consensus, which could delay the process. The five permanent members of the UN Security Council themselves are among the biggest global arms exporters.
A lot of the UN-level negotiations are about trying to have some kind of control on small weapons, and there's a lot of resistance to it by lobbying groups in the United States, for instance. This is now very big money. And it's very big money for everybody along the trading line. So a lot of people have a stake in keeping the flow going.
There are about 875 million small arms and light weapons in circulation today. About 650 million of those are in the hands of civilians. About 8 million weapons are produced newly every single year. About 10 to 14 billion rounds of ammunition are produced every year. That's enough weapons to arm 1 in every 8 people and enough ammunition to shoot everyone in the world twice. And women often bear the brunt of the damage done by small arms and light weapons. While they may not be the majority of conflict deaths or injuries, they have to deal with the aftermath of these weapons. They may be the targets of sexual violence at the barrel of a gun. They may be attacked in refugee camps or as they are trying to collect wood or food for their families. So women, although they are not necessarily the combatants in these conflicts, are often the victims of these weapons.
It's hard to overstate the tremendous destructive capacity those wars have. They don't just hurt people, they destroy everything. They destroy ways of life, ways of thinking, educational processes, traditional role modeling, all of the things are gone. And it's women who are the keeper of what survives in those conflicts.
The small arms and light weapons also survive the conflicts. And disarmament is a key challenge where, some argue, women should have a stronger role.
Usually, disarmament is a process that is dominated by outsiders. The UN comes, they bring in their experts, and these experts are supposed to collect weapons. A lot of these experts that come didn't live or doesn't live in these communities to know who held guns or who didn't. You have to also find community members to help you take those arms up. And who are those community members that are in the best position to do so? Some of the mothers who know that their sons were fighters. The level with which we achieve disarming these boys will determine whether we live peacefully.
In Afghanistan, the proliferation of weapons has had a profound impact on the daily lives of people like Shahida Hossein. Here in Kandahar, she tries to maintain family life in a weak state dominated by warlords, while a US-led coalition battles the Taliban insurgency.
There are stockpiles of weapons, and people are bringing them as we speak. Where do so many weapons come from that you can have 80 men around you as guards? Where did all these weapons come from? Where are we getting all these weapons?
This atmosphere of potential violence means that even a women's rights activist like Hussein can find she misses the relative security that prevailed under the Taliban's repressive regime of the late 1990s.
During the Taliban era, women went out wearing burqas. They traded, made purchases, went from one house to another, went on picnics to Dala, Arjandab, went wherever with their husbands, their brothers, their fathers. However, in these conditions, since the Americans came to Afghanistan, now in Kandahar, we can't go on picnics, we can't go to the market, we can't eat at restaurants, you see. Will there be a suicide attack? Will American tanks or NATO forces pass by and open fire on people? You see, it's a place of great fear.
For non-combatant civilian populations today, national security is less important than a more people-centered view of stability, which some are now calling human security.
Human security is really an alternative to national security. It's about protecting the security of the individual and the communities in which they live, rather than the security of states and borders. So the way in which you deal with these kinds of conflicts is extremely different. You have to do it through dampening down violence. You have to do it through protecting ordinary people. You have to do it through trying to develop a rule of law and a legitimate political authority. It's particularly important that nowadays the source of war is not enemy states. It's not actually Russia and China and Iran and North Korea. The source of war is actually weak states. It's Bosnia, it's Afghanistan, and they're also the source of terrorism. And the way you deal with those wars is not through defeating them. In fact, if you use military force, you further weaken those states. That's what happened when we invaded Iraq and Afghanistan.
We learned a pretty hard lesson in these latest wars, whether it's in Afghanistan or in Iraq for that matter, which is that when the population doesn't feel secure, it's very hard to win their hearts and minds. And when you aren't winning their hearts and minds, they're not going to make choices in favor of your forces. They are going to hedge their bets and perhaps help the terrorists. And so making the population secure turns out to be very, very important to making the state secure.
The U.S. military in Afghanistan realized it had made a crucial mistake. It was failing to connect with half the country's population. Rural Afghan women, though rarely seen by outsiders, hold the key to understanding life in the villages. By not fully engaging them, the military was missing out on a vital source of information and an opportunity to win hearts and minds.
All right, let's go, girls.
Army Sergeant First Class Abby Blaisdell leads a female engagement team, or FET.
Yes.
One of about 75 such teams now operating in provinces throughout the country.
We're maybe going to get the word to go up and do some talking with some women or children. We want to see what kind of issues they may have in this area, whether it's healthcare or if they need school for their children. We just wanted to make sure that you saw that we brought the doctor back to help the women.
In tribal Pashtun areas, women are often forbidden from interacting with men unless bonded by marriage or blood. The all-female units give the military new access to a world that was formerly out of reach.
Actually, we're very well received out here right now as Western women because we don't fall under the Muslim rules and we're not as imposing as the male soldiers. We're gonna go right in here. Just have one guy stand here for security, sir, and we'll be good inside. Basically, it's our goal to go out and engage the women within the population of Afghanistan and try to find out what their needs are and how we can assist them to improve their quality of life.
Are they healthy?
Sergeant Blaisdell, her medic, and her translator check in with the village elder before moving on.
Ask her if the women that we visited with yesterday, that our doctor treated, if they were satisfied with the treatment they received. It's very important that we all work together, especially as women, because we have a lot of good ideas, and sometimes the men don't know to listen to our ideas. But if we all work together, we can probably bring some resolution much more quickly.
Do these stories.
When are they going to do that?
When you start thinking about women and war, you really change your idea about what security is. Security becomes, is there water out of the tap, or is the well polluted? You begin thinking about electricity and what happens to women's security when electricity fails. How do they make a living in the middle of the war? Makes you think about really a more realistic notion of security.
Human security is utterly out of reach for vast numbers of people who are being uprooted from their land and their homes inside their own countries. The number of civilians who have been internally displaced by conflicts worldwide has increased more than 65% since the Cold War ended.
Pushing people off their land is a strategy of war. It could be the objective of the war. In Colombia, for example, land that's inhabited by indigenous people, by Afro-Colombians, by poor peasants, is wanted by insurgent groups, by militias. They want this land.
In May 2002, Afro-Colombian citizens had to abandon the village of Bohaya in the wake of the worst civilian massacre in some 40 years of violence in Colombia.
It was the 1st of May when the confrontation between the paramilitaries and the guerrillas took place.
Maria Eugenia Velasquez and her family were some of the few who survived.
When I heard it, I didn't know if it was thunder or shooting.
Right-wing paramilitaries had been positioned on one side of the village. Guerrillas known as the FARC were on the other, fighting for control of this region on Colombia's Pacific coast, a crucial transit zone for the gold and cocaine trades. The guerrillas attacked, lobbing a gas cylinder bomb, which veered off course. It exploded in a church where villagers had sought sanctuary from the fighting.
We looked at the back, and people were running, crying, screaming, and naked. A guy arrived at the house, and he couldn't talk. Until finally he said, everyone in the church died.
119 villagers were killed, most of them women and children. When they fled after the massacre, the people from Bohaya joined some 4 million who have been internally displaced by violent conflict in Colombia, causing one of the worst and least reported humanitarian crises in the world.
Once you're uprooted, there's problems going back to where you came from. A decade can go by. More than half of these situations are protracted. They go on for more than 5 years, sometimes more than a decade or more. So that you then just can't go back to your house. Somebody else is occupying it. It's not a temporary event, displacement. It's something that is a major transformation of your life.
Refugee life, displaced life, is one of the most undignified way of life. It's horrible.
She's totally amazing.
You don't have a comfortable bed. You don't have a comfortable place to sleep. Sometimes medical aid is non-existent. You rarely find food to eat. You become frozen in that moment when you left. So wherever you find yourself, your whole mind about your community is about when you left. And you don't want to take advantage of any opportunity that has been given to you. I'm going home soon. I'm going home soon. It's going to be over soon.
Displacement of populations by violent conflicts is reaching epidemic proportions, which presents huge challenges for the international community as to when to respect a nation's sovereignty and when to intervene.
For the first time, you will accept clearly and unambiguously that you will have a collective response.
At the 2005 World Summit meeting of the UN General Assembly, leading nations made an historic commitment to protect populations from genocide, war crimes, ethnic cleansing, and crimes against humanity.
You will be pledged to act if another Rwanda looms.
An important emerging doctrine in the United Nations and in the international community is the responsibility to protect. After what we saw in Bosnia and elsewhere, what we're seeing in Congo, it is very important that that standard, that new standard, the responsibility that we as humanity have towards others, and that's a new standard that is emerging, that is not applied universally, that it's very defective still, but it's of paramount importance that it becomes universally accepted and enforced priority for everyone.
Well, I will admit that I was somewhat skeptical of the responsibility to protect. Not because I think it's a bad thing, but because I wasn't sure that we actually meant it. I don't mean the United States, I mean the international community. We have to be a little bit careful that it doesn't become a responsibility to protect when someone is about to mow down his people quickly on CNN. But there's no responsibility to protect if somehow they're going to mow down their people slowly and not on CNN. I am one who believes that something probably had to be done in Libya, particularly given the context of the Arab Spring.
On Saturday morning, a woman called Eman Al-Abadi burst into the restaurant of our hotel. She said she'd been held at gunpoint by four Gaddafi militiamen and then repeatedly raped. Look what Gaddafi's militiamen have done to me, she shouted. They have violated my honor. It was a story the government minders here did not want told.
Nowadays, we are very much focused on rape as a weapon of war. And that is so different from a war between two states where you try to destroy the other people's army. This is a very nasty weapon of war. Very nice, very effective, very cheap, very long-lasting.
Patrick Cammert, now retired as a Dutch Major General, commanded United Nations peacekeeping units in Cambodia, Bosnia, Ethiopia, Eritrea, and the Democratic Republic of Congo.
I've spent a large part of my military career operating in conflict zones.
He shocked the United Nations with his first-hand testimony about the increasing use of rape as a weapon of war.
It has probably become more dangerous to be a woman than a soldier in an armed conflict.
I've seen in my career, I thought, all of the atrocities, till the moment that I was faced with atrocities against women and girls in any particular sexual violence. I was not prepared for that kind of violence. It is beyond belief. Any armed group that is using rape as a weapon and a tactic of war is destroying the community. The women are booted out of the community. Husbands are divorcing their wives. They are mentally broken, and therefore it is such an effective weapon. Demoralize, humiliate those people, and destroy the fabrics of the society.
I think it took a while for the community that was dealing with this to understand that these weren't isolated incidents.
Douglas Farah reported from Liberia and Sierra Leone and says the world was slow to realize how systematic war rapes had become.
It wasn't teenage boys with guns out of control who were acting out of lust, which is part of the way it was viewed during the early parts of those conflicts, to realizing that it was a well-thought-out, methodical thing that becomes integrated into the children after they're taken from their families, given a gun, trained up. They're also taught, if not verbally by the action of their superiors, that rape is an integral part of being in that armed unit.
Up until the Hague trial for Bosnia and Rwanda, women's stories in war and what happened to women were not addressed and not prosecuted.
Iraqi-born Zainab Salbi works with women survivors of war in post-conflict zones worldwide.
The story is a long story and an old story, actually. From the rape of 900,000 German women in World War II by Russian soldiers to break their Germanic honor, to the rape of Bangladeshi women by the Pakistani soldiers in the Bangladesh Independent War in 1971.
In the 1971 war, in which Bangladesh split from Pakistan, it is estimated that between 200 and 400,000 women were tortured and raped by Pakistani soldiers. But it was not until 1992, when war broke out in Bosnia, that rape began to be seen as something other than an inevitable byproduct of war.
And the change happened for a few reasons, in my opinion. A, talking about it, breaking the story. But that took women's willingness to talk. You see, all the stories that I told you before, Bangladesh, German women, all of that, there's an utter and absolute silence about that.
The 11-month-old war in Bosnia has revealed horrors unknown in Europe for the past 50 years. Besieged cities, concentration camps, and increasing reports of the mass rape of thousands of women. All the horrors carried out in the name of tribalistic ethnic cleansing.
The artillery barrage was creeping towards us in the villages on the Muslim side in Tzemach. Numbers are difficult to estimate, but it's possible that as many as 20,000 people are on the move, most of them by foot. These have been walking for 2 days. They had gone 18 miles, had at least another 20 to go.
When fleeing Muslims reached the hometown of history professor Fadila Mamicevic, she realized it was vitally important that the events unfolding in front of her be documented.
When the refugees started coming to our city in waves, we recorded everything.
Mamicevic quickly organized 450 volunteers to help record first-hand accounts of the brutality being committed against Bosnian Muslims by Serb forces.
The woman had a need to talk to me. Their stories would go along the lines of, they took my husband to a camp. I was at home. The entire village was cleansed. And my neighbor, or my cousin, or a close friend, was imprisoned and constantly raped. After 2 weeks or a month, this same woman would come to my office and ask to speak in private. Then they would say, the woman I told you about before, I was really talking about me. Most of them were pregnant at that point.
Mamicevic says she alone interviewed or received statements from around 10,000 female rape victims, and she carefully noted which among them would be willing to be witnesses at trial. In the process, she compiled a list of more than 1,300 suspected perpetrators of war rape in Bosnia.
It was never one man, never. Usually an entire military unit participated. Those women who are a part of Bosnian patriarchal traditional society, and most of them were homemakers, the pillars of their families. They were suddenly uprooted, humiliated. And that was the intention of those rapes.
The evidence Mamishevich compiled was so thoroughly documented, it caught the attention of the famous hunter of Nazi war criminals, Simon Wiesenthal.
He looked through the documentation and then said, "Ms. Mamishevich, you know what? You have the documents, but also witnesses who are alive. I only have documentation. I'm still searching for witnesses around the world."
All right, the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia Islamic Session.
Her files were crucial evidence in getting rape recognized as a war crime by the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia that was established in The Hague in 1993.
When I arrived at the United Nations, the major issues that I had to deal with when I got there had to do with Bosnia. There is an echo in this chamber today. The Nuremberg principles have been reaffirmed. The lesson that we are all accountable to international law may have finally taken hold in our collective memory. I'm proud of many votes that I took, but the one that I thought really made a difference in terms of this issue was voting for a war crimes tribunal against those who were perpetrating the ethnic cleansing and the crimes in Bosnia. Among them were primarily the crimes about women. And we, in fact, did lobby to get women on the war crimes tribunal, and rape was declared a crime of war. A very big step forward.
Thank you very much, Ashley. We have, I think, about a half an hour to chat, and I'm sorry that we can't see the whole thing, but we wanted to at least offer a pretty good segment of what obviously is an incredibly gripping and just amazing piece of documentary footage. In my mind, it tells the extraordinary story both of the abuse of women, the violence committed against women in this era of new wars, although as they went back and discussed what happened in Berlin and when this, during the Soviet occupation after the first, Second World War, you know, this goes back a lot further. You know, reminds me a little bit of Mother Courage trying to keep her family alive in the 30 Years' War. But obviously, this has been going on forever. But what's amazing, and I think comes through in your work, is the degree to which it's also an amazing story of heroic women who, in particular women, who have begun to speak out about this and try to change some of the norms and some of, and try to reframe what we think about security in terms of human security. It reminds me, when I was working as an international affairs fellow, I was working at the State Department during the first term of the Bush administration, and I inherited the Afghan desk at some stage in the policy planning staff. And the definition of security that the United States was largely operating with was Al-Qaeda on the run. Yeah. And the definition of security that the Afghan government was operating with was, are we basically having the Taliban on the run, and do we basically have the warlords under control? But in poll after poll, the major security concern of the Afghan people, not least Afghan women, was, could we please get some rule of law to get rid of these thugs who are preying upon us on a day-to-day basis? And it's no surprise that there was a certain amount of nostalgia for the Taliban, notwithstanding their incredibly draconian aspects. Anyway, I don't want to monopolize the conversation, but I did want to ask sort of one question. Just thinking about the policy implications of some of the stuff that you've talked about, you know, there has been some move, it seems to me, that's not just window dressing towards trying to move in a human security direction. I don't want to exaggerate it. A lot of national security traditionalists in this town, say the least. You know, but peacekeepers taking on an increasing protection agenda that might include, in particular, trying to protect female members of a displaced population. Although, again, totally under-resourced, and I have sympathy for the UN that tries to take up this mandate in Eastern Congo, and it just is almost impossible to do given the distances and the logistics involved. It's a responsibility to protect, mm-hmm. and then the gradual sense of the accountability for war crimes and transitional justice has to include some of the most heinous crimes against women. So it seems to me that there's progress being made, but yet, you know, there's still so many other things that need to be done. And I'm just wondering if you've had a chance to engage in any U.S. policymakers or others, international policymakers, and or have some thoughts about what more, in a sense, needs to be done.
Right. Well, 1325 has been discussed at most length in the international community around the notion of protection. But it's actually a much richer and more complex document than just a discourse on protection. And it really goes at length into the question of what role women should play in rebuilding, whether they should be at peace talks, what role will they play in governance going forward. And I would venture to guess that a lot of the insufficiency in the protection agenda has stemmed from the sole focus on a protection agenda, without, in fact, wholehearted conviction around the centrality of women in making plans and addressing governance and other causes of conflict such as that. So I think that where they have particularly most egregiously failed in Eastern Congo, it has really actually been in every place where they've overly focused on protection to the point of paternalism, you know, and that's there's no better word for it. They have not brought women into governance. They have not brought women into decision making. They haven't talked to women about which villages to send people to and which villages not to. They haven't talked to women about where the weapons are, where the militias are, where the potential problem spots are. And so they're really operating on a business as usual basis, just with a slightly different emphasis on protection. So they have really only they've only nuanced, but they haven't really fundamentally altered the way they operate, at least at the peacekeeping level and in Eastern Congo, which I know better than the rest of these. And Lema Bowie and I took the Pray the Devil Back to Hell to Eastern Congo, and we went to three different cities and we talked to 35 women activists from all over lots of different sectors, including the military sector and the police sector, about their priorities. And two very interesting things happened. In each of these three cities, it was the same routine. Every time we asked them for their own priorities, they would sit in silence and stare at us and ask us if we were completely serious, because, in fact, no one had ever asked them before what their priorities were. So right at the beginning, I think you get a very important piece of information, which is we've never actually asked them for anything, and there might be something they could tell us. But the other thing was that they, in none of these cities, named sexual violence as their top priority for addressing in terms of building peace going forward. And they all named women's political participation as their top priority. And when I asked them, one woman actually was so angry at me, she was practically spitting. And she said, "Oh, we are so tired of you coming from the global north asking us for your most dramatic rape story, first of all. There's a prurience to the interest in the rape stories. And if I were shot in my arm, you wouldn't ask for the kind of detailed description of my injury as you would expect of this description of the rape. But what you're addressing is not the problem, it's the symptom of the problem. And unless we have value, unless we're central, unless we're deemed as critical actors, we're never going to address the sexual violence problem." So I think that because these institutions tend to be a mix of traditionalists and people who want to think another way, they tend, when they want to change, to only half change. And I think to some extent we almost make things worse when we half change. We should either keep business as usual or really commit to this theory that women are really fundamentally going to make a difference. I'm really sad we couldn't watch to the end because the film, right where we stopped, is right where it sort of pivots and starts to talk a little bit about peace building and why that matters.
Yeah, and I noticed it just in terms of participation that Afghanistan, for instance, in the Bonn conference, the original one, 10 years ago, there was a reasonably significant participation amongst of women in that, and yet in this conference, so far, at least in the preparatory sessions, there have not been.
No.
And a comment was made in the earlier event we had today that by Sena Mandarlini that we have got to stop having peace negotiations and peace conferences that only put in place or only listen to those folks who have the guns and again making the point that external actors, to the degree that they have leverage over some of these processes,
right,
need to try to use that leverage as much as possible to push
inclusion. I mean, the guys with the guns matter, of course, right? Because nobody's happy if they decide to pick them back up again.
Right.
And so there is this fundamental aspect of security, which is, taking the motivation out of it for the guys who have the guns. And so they have to be at the peace talks.
Mm-hmm.
It's not that they don't matter, but every time you have a peace talk, it's the guys with the guns and then some civil society actors and some non-governmental organizations, some international organizations. And among all of those potential sources of women, you just never have women. And so we're still at under 3% of signatories to peace agreements being women. And so Winston Churchill famously said that those who make war tend not to make good peace. And it's a pretty fundamental preset. They don't have a clue whether it's a road or a well that this village needs. That's not what their expertise is. That's not what they're interested in. They've never really understood that. That's what women understand, and that's what we need to be privileging when we go into peace.
Let's go now to any questions from all of you. Please, we usually do this if you want to get a question in, but if you wave, I'll acknowledge you as well. Ann Richard.
Hi, Ann Richard from the International Rescue Committee, and my colleagues and I are just thrilled by this series, and it's a wonderful job telling, a very difficult story. And so they're so psyched by the series. So, and I've seen parts of it, but not all of it. And so this was interesting to watch this snippet. I'm curious to find out, I know we should talk about the substance, but I'm also interested in the filmmaking, how you selected the experts you chose. I mean, you have some wonderful, some of my personal heroes, like Patrick K. Martin, Roberta Cohen. But what I'm also curious to hear, what has been the reception to the series? Have you gotten enough attention to it? I mean, if something is on PBS on a Tuesday night, several...
Oh, I'm there.
Weeks in a fall. I'm really psyched that you can watch it online, which did because I got half of it the other day. And then I'm also curious to hear about how Lemmon Bowie winning the Nobel Peace Prize factored into trying to bring attention to the series and getting people to take these issues seriously.
Right. Well, first of all, in terms of Lemmon Bowie, you have to go home and turn on the Comedy Channel because she's on The Daily Show tonight. And I'm really annoyed that I'm not maybe Jon Stewart with her right now. But okay, I'll forgive you all that. So we have gotten some serious traction because of the Nobel Prize, and that definitely helped us a lot. We had the usual PBS problems. It is a little bit like a tree falling in a forest and nobody hearing, because PBS is PBS. It's a shrinking audience for everybody on television, but especially for PBS. And they're really resource challenged, as you know. So we did not have an advertising budget. And barring an advertising budget, what we figured was the most strategic way to think about this was... So we have a limited amount of people we can reach. Let's reach the people who really need to pull this message forward for us. So we started building a grassroots outreach campaign in January. We've been working for 10 months to build partnerships with the IRC and other large NGOs that are international, as well as small community-based organizations that care about women and women's issues. There are domestic violence organizations in Coney Island that care about women and peace building in Bosnia just as much as they care about what's happening in Coney Island. And it's really extraordinary how much they care and will turn out for this kind of thing. So I think we did very well in terms of ratings and numbers of people turning out, considering that actually we literally, through grassroots and social networking, we literally reached out and touched out our every single member of our audience in one way or another through social marketing campaigns and email and so forth. So I sense that, and I hope that I'm not just kidding myself, that we've added real juice to the conversation that was going on before us in little, very obscure communities around the edges. I sense that this conversation is starting to move to the mainstream a little bit more. I'm sensing some energy from journalists who 2 years ago when we approached them about this project couldn't have cared less. So there is an increasing amount of energy, and what we're hoping is that given how many years we have not paid attention to this, because this isn't just a question of 1325 and what women can do in the 21st century. This, you know, goes back to the Trojan women and all the many years that we have failed or persisted in refusing to see the role that women play in wartime. There has just been a shift in the way people understand it. So we could only hope to be the beginning of a conversation given that level of difference between the reality and what actually happens in media. And our fingers are crossed that everyone, like the IRC and so forth, in the Council for Foreign Relations, will pick up this conversation and run with it, and hopefully use these materials.
I was interested that there was an interview with Hillary Clinton where she, you know, is a big fan.
Hillary is all over this, and this has been, her heart has been in this for a long time. This is not new to her. Yeah, to have her at state as such an articulate advocate for these issues is so powerful. But, you know, that Condoleezza Rice is understanding these issues is also
very important. Yeah.
Quite important, and she was a voice for them, and she was the advocate for 1888, and so she is really... also, interestingly, given you know the tenor of the State Department on her watch, very interested in these issues as well. So there is an argument to be made that maybe women soften things up even in the most hawkish of administrations. I think we've crossed a Rubicon. I'm not sure we can go back from where we are.
Vivian, Derek, please.
Thank you, and thank you, Abby, for this remarkable series. And I just gotta say that you are such a good storyteller. We talk about this all the time, that we learn by stories, but you make it live, you make the concept live. And so we thank you for that. I have two questions, and I suppose they might be a little bit esoteric. One is about 1325, and you talked about the fact that we really haven't seen it work in terms of protection. Mm-hmm. I mean, we haven't seen it turn move beyond just protection and that being paternalistic. When you meet with women from women's groups, do any of them talk about 1325 and what that means? Mm-hmm. The second question is, one of the participants talked about human security versus national security. Mm-hmm. And I think that the two are related, so that you can't have national security without human security. Mm-hmm. And has that come up in any of your conversations?
Yes, and yes, absolutely. The women around the world are more aware of 1325 than most people in the United States are, and especially women living in conflict zones. Actually, I have to say this for UN Women and before at UNIFEM, they've done a good job of making sure that advocates in areas where there's conflict at least understand they have this, even if it's only on paper, because it's not mandated, it's not funded, and it really doesn't have any teeth in it, but at least they have this concept mm-hmm. to appeal to. So it's a very important mechanism in a place like Liberia, where the government is really obviously very behind it in a substantive way. It can really mean a lot in terms of where the resources wind up, which is, let's face it, that's the important place. And you tend to see this in the Afghan film, if you watch it, the closer they get to the dividing up of the stuff, the further and further women get from the center. So you know where the stuff is by how few women are at the table. So the, at 1325 winds up being a really important piece of the puzzle for them. And now I'm forgetting the second question. The second question was...
So human versus national
security. Human versus national security. That's a kind of an abstruse idea and distinction for people living on the ground. That's more of a wonky set of ideas. And I know that human security itself is an idea that has a certain amount of controversy linked to it. Look, the idea that women's rights and human rights are connected has some controversy attached to it, too. So there are some very fundamental questions that we're still actually wrangling around in the world of people who just live in their brains. At the level of people who are actually wondering where the water is and the firewood, I don't think anything could possibly matter less to them, except for the fact that they know and they understand, and this is something the Afghan women we worked with has said to us, it's not going to happen because two people signed a piece of paper in a room. It's going to happen if we make it happen at the ground, and then it grows up from there. 85% of peace agreements fail within the first 5 years. This has historically always been the case. So actually, national security has never really been a concept that has been very successful in bringing us peace up till now. So maybe a fresh look at it.
Can I just pick up on that as someone who does spend his life living in his head at a think tank as opposed to sort of on the ground? Not even able to tie his shoes most days. I would say that, I mean, it is obviously a live question, particularly amongst sort of, you know, would-be national security types, as to, you know, the worry with human security sometimes as well, it's infinitely expandable, and what does it really refer to? I think that the most effective approach from the perspective of those who care about this issue would be to try to bound human security, by and large, reasonably narrowly to sort of protection of life and not sort of like every aspect of material well-being, which is sometimes expanded to. And then once you say that, then it becomes easy to have the conclusion that Condi Rice stumbled onto, that if people in the country don't feel secure, then there's probably not going to be that much security, and therefore it's going to be hard for us to accomplish our aims. I think that if frame it like that, it probably becomes a little bit easier.
I always say that there are aha moments, and then
there's
a duh moment. Okay.
I'm going to take a question. I'm going to take questions two at a time here, in the interest of time. Sharon Brinkow, and then Allison Asplin.
Thanks so much, and I wish my name were as easy as Patrick.
my problem is that people reverse it. So.
Different problem, but thank you. Let me add my voice to the chorus, and thank you for taking on this tough challenge. I think it's hard to get your mind around this set of issues, and for the first time for me, watching three episodes, which I've gotten to, thus far, I've understood things in a way that I hadn't before, so I want to thank you for that. I think that, so I'm at the State Department now, and we look at these issues in part with Milan Brevere's office as women as victims, and you have told us so clearly that story about women as victims, and we start to understand it. We want at the same time to offer hope, and I think the first episode, the way that it ended with the outcome of the War Crimes Tribunal, offers hope. My question for you is on the economics side. So I think we're aiming toward political participation for women to bring this hope. But I'm wondering if in your, as you've developed this, you've worked on the economic dimension. And I say that coming from the science side, because I think science and technology offer women jobs, they offer women hope, and move them into more political participation. So as we look at two sides of the coin, I'm interested to hear your thoughts.
Great. And let's get the second question, if we could, from Allison on the table.
Nice grouping. My question is somewhat related. I'm a grad student at the Johns Hopkins School of Advanced International Studies. And I and my classmates, I think a lot of us are going to go on to advise the U.S. government, foreign governments, international organizations on what they should be doing policy-wise, strategy-wise, and program-wise. And so I love the idea of conveying a story, and that's so powerful, but I wanted to ask you, you know, what do you see things that are generalizable from these stories that I can kind of take back and say, you know, here are things that we can do in our careers to make a difference so that these things don't happen? Mm.
Well, it's hard for me to boil things into numbers and dollars and cents, and we didn't cover the economic dimension except sort of in a sideways way by talking about how important livelihoods are. But there is this important economic dimension to it, and I think actually Bosnia is a place that really tells this story well because, you know, in fact, at the end of the Bosnia hour, when they, the women who were victimized, go back to the town of Foča, I don't know if you've seen this hour, but it's a very horrible moment where they go to lay a plaque at the place where they were raped, and they are basically expelled from the town, people making the Chetnik sign as they go. Women, mostly. Yeah. And it's a horrible, upsetting moment. What hasn't happened in Bosnia, I mean, we tell the story of the international court and the 16 women who testify, and they get a guilty verdict. They get not such a satisfying sentence, but still, you know, there's a sort of quasi-satisfaction in that, but yet we go back to this woman who's still in the national courts looking to have her case prosecuted, and there's no satisfaction, and we find out that fewer than 28 cases have been tried in the national courts of like $40,000, $50,000 women who've been raped. So what you have is, I mean, justice is a piece of reconciliation. You can't have reconciliation without justice. It's very clear that the international community has not invested in real reconciliation in Bosnia. And you go to a place like Foča and you go anywhere in Bosnia or Croatia and you see it very clearly. There's been no reconciliation. And my feeling is, we could borrow against that many billions of dollars we're gonna spend in 5 or 10 years on peacekeeping forces and everything else that we're gonna pour into that place when it does erupt, and it will erupt, on reconciliation now, and we'll get it for pennies on the dollar. Am I a wonk? You'd have to ask Stewart the question of whether in fact these numbers bear out. But I suspect there is an economic argument to be made for really committing to reconciliation. And you know, we were talking earlier about many of the people in uniform that I've met, that Stewart's met, to talk about these issues. They're saying this very same thing. You know, you can't keep asking us to be deployed into places to do things we essentially can't do. There are no more battles of the Bulge. We're not going to fight that war ever again. This is asymmetrical wars. This is counterterrorism and counterinsurgency. These are ethnic wars and tribal conflicts. These are hatreds among peoples. And these are conflicts that we, as the largest military power on Earth, can't win. We can win them, but in the long run, in fact, we lose them in a real sense. And so the bottom line going forward into the 21st century is going to be reconciliation and conflict prevention and conflict resolution, and the heart and soul of these things is going to always be women. And so that's really the bottom line. If we want to save ourselves the heartache and the billions of dollars intervening in abstruse and incredibly unreconcilable conflicts, let's spend it now on the reconciliation up front. In terms of generalizations, that's actually why I think these films stand as a really interesting total statement, and that's why we wanted to make this comprehensive series, because my experience was constantly the same, where if you go to talk to combatants about wars, as Zainab Salbi says at the beginning of this, you get the weapons, and you get the landscape, and you get the ethnic conflict, and the governance, and you get all of that, and all of that is really important, and all of that makes every conflict into the snowflake of complexity. You know, I cannot compare this one to that one because they're all so different and hopelessly unparsable. But the fact is, when you talk to women about conflict, they use the same vocabulary, they use the same language no matter where they're from. And I can't tell you what an extraordinary feeling it is to sit in an edit room and see a woman from Colombia use the same words, adjusted for translation, obviously, for what it feels like to be displaced as a woman from Afghanistan uses. To me, that's incredibly important, you know, and there is a kind of, there's this sort of unwritten rule that you can't sound emotional in rooms like this, that you can't, you know, you can't say, well, what are we doing? This is nuts, you know, I mean, it's just not, it's unprofessional and uncollegial. But, you know, but the reality is, I think my grandmother used to always say the devil is in the details, you know, that expression. I think I've decided to take it and make it my own expression. The devil is in the details in the sense that sometimes the details allow you to not be thinking about what it is that you're actually doing. Hmm. And that's the difference between listening to the combatants about the conflict and listening to the women about the conflict. Because they tell you a universal story about fire and fear and starvation and running and children and water. They tell you that story, and that's the story, you know, that brings us all back to the same place.
Go with two more, please. Anne Crittenden and Maria McFarland.
Hi, thanks again. It's congratulations.
Thank you.
It is totally eye-opening, and it's a wonderful piece of work. One thing that occurs to me is that this crime would not be so powerful if it weren't for these local, for these customs that humiliate women.
Yeah.
I have a close friend who was raped twice in 20 years. It was not a shame. Her husband was not, you know what I'm saying. Mm-hmm. She identified the guy in a lineup and he went to prison. Once it happened in New York and once in Italy.
Wow.
In these cultures, it's far more serious. So you talk about reaching Americans with this, but what can Americans do mm-hmm. about the cultures that make this such a horrible event?
Right.
And have we thought about that? Have you got any ideas about getting to the culture where these other women are pointing at these women, that kind of thing?
Right, right, right.
Great, Maria.
Thanks. Abigail, first I want to thank you and say I was very pleased to see that this was happening at CFR because I used to cover Colombia for Human Rights Watch. I'm still there. Mm-hmm. And the voice of Colombian women is rarely heard even in Colombia and certainly not here. So I'm pleased you included that in your section in one of your segments. But my question's a little different, and that is more specifically, can you talk about where the gaps are in U.S. policy? We obviously Secretary Clinton is a big advocate of these issues. We have Moran Verveer's office, but is there more that can be done? Where exactly would you want to see changes? Mm-hmm. And perhaps a related question is, how do we take advantages of opportunities in North Africa? Mm-hmm. In Libya, for example, you know, you included that piece about the one case, but the role of women in the new government is mm-hmm. not clear. And what should the U.S. be doing on that front?
Both hard questions. Both really hard questions. I remember asking a woman in Morocco about her hijab, and she said to me, I don't know why you Americans think you have it so good. She said, I never suck my stomach in, you know, and I don't know anybody with anorexia. And you know, more than that, you know, when I walk down the street, I'm pretty sure I'm safe. So while culturally there may be in a lot of these places the enormous punitive, awful atmosphere around having been raped, that usually goes hand in hand with not having an expectation of being raped twice in 20 years, too. So there is a bit of a trade-off in these cultures.
Oh, I don't buy that.
I would argue that as American women, it's not necessarily the most advisable thing for us to go and to look to change their culture. Partly because we won't succeed. I mean, we won't.
Exactly. That's why I asked the question. It seems to me it has to come from somewhere else.
Right. I think it has to come from them. And I think that we've more than made the case in the films that we've made that there are plenty of women there who have the power and the capacity to do that. The Afghan Women's Network that we feature in the Afghan film, you know, barely gets enough in grant money to keep the lights on month to month in their program. So as much as everybody goes to Afghanistan and says all the right things about supporting Afghan women, nobody's supporting Afghan women. There is no grant money flowing to them where they are. Sakina Yakubi, who runs a $5 million organization that educates several hundred thousand Afghan women every year, again, every year has to raise whole cloth, $5 million by basically the willpower and shoe leather and even personally humiliating herself on several occasions. It's kind of an awful thing to watch her do every year. So I think that if we made them a higher priority, if we credited them more in all their capacity, their organizations wouldn't be in the kind of struggle they're in, which is just so much greater than the struggle is for the other NGOs that they're up against in competition for this money. So to combine these two questions, I think that we could, through USAID and our other large grant-making institutions, you know, make women a higher priority, you know? And I think that these cultures will shift as women shift from inside of them. But I think if we go in and tell them, you know, that they can't be leaving their wives when they're raped.
No one here was suggesting that.
Yeah.
I mean, please,
yeah, exactly.
You're creating a straw man.
Yeah. But I mean, it's such a delicate thing. Yeah. It's such a delicate thing, right? Because I don't know if we necessarily can say. I mean, we do have it better, but I don't know if we can say that we know it all. That's the distinction I'm making. And I would rather the Afghan women lead and we facilitate what it is that they want to lead on. And there are women. There are women. Constantly what you hear from the aid organizations and the foundations is there aren't enough women for us to fund. We can't find them.
There aren't enough women to fund.
We can't find the good women. There aren't enough women for the Jirga. There aren't enough women for the Bonn Conference. There are enough women. There are more than enough women. You just have to will to go and find them. You know, and no one ever, you know, constantly there's the pushback on, oh, but they're not as sophisticated, they don't know what they're doing, and nobody ever pushes back on some of the men who show up at these conferences. So I think...
Including the Western ones, right?
I think that it involves us really putting our money where our mouth is in supporting women's organizations, indigenous women's organizations, for all our insecurities about how corrupt or how incompetent or how not sophisticated they are. I think we have to take a leap of faith with those organizations, and I would say that's the same answer to your question. I think that we haven't made enough of a commitment to these organizations and building their capacity and giving them what they really need. The average women's organization has a budget around the world, globally, has a budget of under $10,000 a year. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's absurd. The number is small for the average NGO worldwide of any kind. But
just to follow on that scale, it's probably better for private sector to be doing this.
Private, yes. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Well, if they would
risks,
do it.
They can take risks.
If they would
government
do it.
Organizations will never do.
Yeah, if they would do it, and they haven't been doing it. And believe me, I've spent
that's
20 years trying to get them
really
to do
helpful.
It. And they won't do it.
Okay. Abby, I think we'll probably finish with these last two questions that are up, Regina Wall and Steve Steiner. And you haven't asked yours yet, have you?
No. Yeah.
Okay, we'll start with Regina from OSD. It doesn't have to be the official position of the Pentagon, but
it's probably not. I wanted to ask about another aspect of this, and you just kind of touched on it in answering Sharon's question, which is, what can we do to do a better job of utilizing women's perspective, women's experience, women's particular needs in conflict prevention? That's a part of 1325. It's a key part of all of this. Aside from doing a better job in terms of peace negotiations at the end of one conflict to prevent it from mm-hmm. kind of turning immediately into another, what else can we do?
Right.
How do we address that?
Right.
And Steve?
Yeah, it's really a comment, but it goes right to your comments, Abby. We're running a project at USIP trying to get all of the NGOs and government offices and got the Europeans and Canadians involved too, to try to find out how we can do a better job to support women in Afghanistan and Iraq, recognizing that everybody's budget's being cut back, sometimes drastically. And we've developed, you know, a list of best practices, lessons learned, and all that. But what we need to do as a next step, and we're not very skilled at that, I think, is to go public and make the case that these women are leaders, not victims. Mm-hmm. That's what we need to do. And we need to find the right allies for that. And I happen to agree with Anne that I think, to some extent, these allies might be in the private sector.
Right.
But,
right.
you know, I'm just looking for advice and right. Counsel on how to reach out and take that next step.
Right. Yeah, the operative words for us in making this was subjects, not objects, because they really get boiled down into objects, not subjects in these films. What can we do? I think that in the Daily Beast, I just last week posted an interview I did with Patrick Kamaret, who has been chomping at the bit for the opportunity to talk about, instead of there are all these rapes, what can we do to stop the rapes? And so we did an interview together where he actually sat down and he said, light the refugee camps, have segregated latrines. There are some very basic things that we know work over the long term in terms of just simply preventing a lot of violence from happening. And he knows these things because he went and he listened. I sort of think that the first 2 years of foreign deployment for anybody in the State Department or the Peace Corps or anywhere should involve a big piece of duct tape over our mouths to go with some humility and actually listen to what people have to say. Yeah. Because, you know, Lema, for all how formidable she is, isn't someone anyone listened to until this film came out. And, you know, they pounded on the doors of the United Nations for months before the disarmament started in Liberia and said, we've been through disarmament, we know how it works. And the United Nations basically said, we have experts, we don't need your help, thank you. And if you see the full-length version of PREY, you'll see what it devolves into. So there, what we're not doing is the listening, and that's very difficult to do. I understand that the listening is incredibly difficult to do. But we were just talking about that the military is a learning institution. It is fundamentally a learning institution, and this is a piece of what it needs to learn how to do, and it has and never done well. I suspect that immediately we think about the private sector because the increments are so small. When you're talking about building women's leadership, you're talking about $10,000 and $5,000 and putting together 20 women in one county and so forth. That is how it's going to work. And one thing the big organizations that fund have never figured out how to do is small. And so they're always talking about getting to scale. Here's what USAID did to a program that we started in Liberia. It's not entirely related, but it's kind of typical of what happens. We started a program where we were taking plastic water bottles, and you could cut them in half and add four parts in there, plug them into a solar panel, and it's a rechargeable solar light. It's terrific, and you can string them up to the ceiling, and you've lit a classroom, and we had a Liberian NGO come in and train everybody in how to install and repair the solar panels and build the lamps. We had market women building the lamps and selling them off their stands so that it was an economic development. The mayor of the town got everybody together to light a classroom, so we had adult education. We were feeling really good about it. This was a program that took us about a year of work, but only $50,000. So the resource that we spent that was valuable was our time and our energy and what we knew, and going to the country and sleeping in uncomfortable places and usually having horrible diarrhea for long periods of time and sorting it out. The check was the easiest part. USAID got wind of it and thought it was a really great idea, and they said, we're going to do it in twice as many, we're going to do it in 200 towns in half the amount of time that you did it with half the amount of money. They hired people that we had already fired because they were corrupt, blah, 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 on and on. This is actually not really USAID's problem. It's a structural problem. It's because they can't think in increments of $50,000. It's impossible. If you have to move $250,000 by Friday, you can't think. So I think that we need to think about these structures so that we get down all the way down to the grassroots, because if we're moving in increments of, the way I think of it is our fingers are really fat. And the good stuff is in the crannies and the nooks, and we need to figure out how to find our way, usually by way of proxies, and agents in these countries who are indigenous to these countries and understand them better than we do. So that's the piece of the learning that needs to start happening.
Well, I'm conscious of the fact that that Abby has a flight to take back to the city that never sleeps, I guess, yes. But I just have one request, and that's when you're on the red carpet at the Emmys, if you remember the little people.
Yes, I will.
Please join me in thanking Abby Disney.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.